And we're now going to talk to Health Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergeire. Undersecretary, good afternoon to you. Thanks for joining us. Welcome to the program.
Good afternoon, Carmina, and good afternoon to all of you.
All right. People were really surprised about the revelation yesterday that the 8 active cases were previously tagged as recovered. Let's talk about what happened there. The first test that administered, the results were positive. And then came the second test results that came out to be negative. And then a third case, the results of that was positive again. First of all, why was there a third test that was needed to be administered on these 8 cases, Undersecretary?
Yes, Carmina, let's try to clear this up. First, our protocol would state that for all of those identified positive individuals, those with symptoms or they were contacts, they were tested initially and they were isolated when they were confirmed to be positive. When they finish their isolation or quarantine, it is not required anymore to have a repeat test. Therefore, if they finish their 10-day isolation or 14-day quarantine, they can already be discharged from their isolation or quarantine. So that was what happened. So some of these individuals who had finished their 14-day quarantine or 10-day isolation were not tested anymore after they were declared to be recovered. Now,
sorry to cut you there, Undersecretary, but why was there a negative result? There was a second test administered if they had finished their quarantine.
Yes, that was what I was pointing out. I was going to point out there were some LGUs who still requires repeat testing after they finish their 10 days or 14 days. So some of them would have this negative test after their quarantine or isolation. Some of them would just be discharged without having this repeat test. Now came the whole genome sequencing results, and these individuals were again monitored closely. We went back to them and we retested. And this is the protocol based from our experts' recommendations that we retest them again. So that was the third test. And based on this, after being tagged as recovered, coming from the local governments, we retested them and they turned out to be positive, these 8 individuals. That's why they were again classified as active cases and they are now in isolation. But one of the things that I would like to point out would be these people or individuals have completed their isolation already. They are all asymptomatic. Their CT values, the cycle threshold values for their RT-PCR results are all very high. Almost most of them more than 35 already.
You said a while ago that after genome sequencing revealed that they were positive with the Delta variant, you had to call them back again and have them retested. The genome sequencing, do you do this for all of the samples?
No, this is just for positive sampling, Carmina. So we are not testing everybody who turns positive. There is this sampling that we are doing because we all only have this kind of capacity right now. But also, even if they have submitted their samples, there are still qualifiers before a sample can be processed. There is this criteria that the cycle threshold of this positive sample should be less than 30 so that it can be qualified to be sequenced. So these are the things that we look at before we can subject it to sequencing.
Okay, so that doesn't mean that some may have slipped through your hands because go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. The whole objective of our whole genome sequencing right now is for us to detect the variant. So when we do our sampling and we see just one case in a specific area, we then do our analysis already and have these kind of assumptions. Again, let me go back. We have this certain capacity right now for our whole genome sequencing, and it is really not going to be sufficient for us to do mass sequencing for all of these positive samples.
Yeah, but you got them, but they were negative already. You're talking about the first positive samples from the first test.
Yes, ma'am. Some of them turned out to be negative. Yes, but most of them did not have repeat tests or the second test before they were discharged. And actually, some of them are still continuing their isolation. So meaning they are still in the isolation facility because when the genome sequencing results were out, so they just continued isolation.
Mm-mm. But we're talking about all of the active cases here, ha, Dr. Vergeire. All of them tested positive, all of the eight tested positive in the first test, tested negative in the second test, tested positive for the Delta variant on the third test. And you're saying you had to call them back for the third test because after genome sequencing, they turned out to be positive with the Delta variant, but they were already negative. And you're saying you're not getting all, you're not doing genome sequencing for all of the results that you receive.
Ma'am, let me just clarify. The RT-PCR test is different from the whole genome sequencing test. Yeah. So when we did the first test, because they had symptoms or exposures, so they had a positive RT-PCR test. And that specific sample was the one which were submitted for whole genome sequencing. So whatever results we had for genome sequencing are based from the first samples that we've had. So some of these individuals, as I've said, because of LGU protocols, they do another or they do repeat tests. And they had this negative antigen test. I think two of them had antigen tests and the others based on LGU protocols. But as again, I want to reiterate our requirements now or our protocol based on experts' recommendations is that we retest all of those who turned out positive for the whole genome sequence for Delta variant so that we have an extra layer of protection.
So it's not true that all of these tests were administered RT-PCR tests, and that's the gold standard. As you just said, the antigen test yielded negative results.
Yes, ma'am. So it's as I've said, we do not consider the second test as something official because as I've said, our general guideline or our protocol would be no repeat test anymore at the end of your isolation or quarantine because most of the time, the individuals who are positive still turns to be out to be positive even on the 14th day when in fact they are no longer infectious. So this delays people inside quarantine or isolation facilities so that we have removed this repeat testing anymore. So the second test really is really just for monitoring or sometimes local government protocols for their extra layer of assessment.
But you still consider these active cases, these eight cases as active cases? Go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. These are classification. If you would notice or you would take note, we have three classifications. We have active cases, we have recoveries, and we have deaths. So whenever, for example, at this point in this instance where we have detected that they are positive, even though they were already tagged as recovered, so we needed to change their classification from recovered to active cases. We do active monitoring among all of them because they are Delta variant cases and they are still positive. But based on our analysis and expert advice, they are already considered more or less non-infectious. But we just want to add that layer of protection for the community.
Okay. How many days in between the second test passed before these cases were called in to have that third test administered?
Oh, well, we had the third test or this retesting among these Delta variant cases on July 17. So some of them are still continuing their isolation. So we just took the test up from the facility that they were isolated. Some of them finished their discharge July 11. So these were 6 days after they were discharged and declared as recovered. Some of them, they finished their isolation July 2. So this is about 15 days after they have had been tagged as recovered.
Okay. And these 6 days, within those six days, is it confirmed that they were no longer infectious because they had finished their isolation period?
That is the decision because that's based on the protocol that if you finish your 10 days or 14 days, you are no longer symptomatic, you are declared as recovered. But as I've said, these are extra layers of protection for us. And as I've said, most of these individuals, these 8 ones, have CT values more than 30. Some have more than 40 already.
All right. Now, I want to talk about what Mayor Isko Moreno has said when he also found out about the reclassification of these cases. He said that they were belatedly informed. In fact, the claim is that he was informed 3 weeks after the carrier's death. This is the head of an LGU who could have done something as well to prevent a possible spread. What happened there, Undersecretary?
Yes, Carmina, we have to understand that whenever you identify a positive case, even without the genome sequencing yet, you need to go through the protocols that we have right now. They have to be isolated immediately and all the management will be done. So we assume that even though the whole genome sequencing results have come out after 3 weeks, they were able to completely manage this patient. So this 14 days or 10 days of isolation should have been done by the local government. Now, why 3 weeks after? First, we need to understand also that we are doing sampling. We are reliant on local government submissions also. So sometimes local governments, in order for them to be more efficient based on their protocols, they do biobanking. They store everything and just submit it to us by in one batch. So most of the time, what they are submitting are outdated samples already. So now we are going to have this protocol that what we are going to prioritize to accept right now are those dated or those timely samples that they are submitting.
Yeah, because quick reaction really is key here. You have to agree with that, right? And if the head of an LGU is belatedly informed of something that could cause something catastrophic, wouldn't that be classified as a failure of some sort in the protocols that you're following?
Let's try to go back to that. Carmina, I take note of what you're saying, and I really take note also of what Mayor Moreno is saying. That is really vital, the timeliness of all of these actions and results. But again, I go back. If we could have, if we were able to do the protocols that has to be done for a positive individual, even though there are no sequencing results yet, we are assured that we were able to contain whatever transmission there would be in the community. This whole genome sequencing is another step for all of us to just determine what type of variant. And we always say, whatever variants we have right now here in the country, as long as we follow the protocols that we have, we will be protected. So I just like to make mention of that.
Yeah, but Undersecretary, all these variants, they're not created equal. I mean, we've seen what is happening in India, Indonesia, you've got the Seychelles, the Maldives. And we do know the capacity of our healthcare system. So it is imperative that whatever variant that is, especially a more transmissible one like the Delta variant, that people have to be informed about it and not just rely on, the protocols are in place. And I think this is also the reason why some people have the opinion that the health department hasn't been, or there is a lack of transparency coming from the health department. What do you say to those observations?
I don't agree with that lack of transparency, Carmina, because we had been very transparent since the start of this pandemic. I just want to inform everybody that this whole genome sequencing result came out last Friday, that was July 16, and immediately we called on the specific local governments before we informed media, before we informed public. We wanted to discuss this with them and the inherent limitations of our capacity and protocols that we have right now. I am not trying to defend, we are not 100% perfect, but I just like to go back again to my point. That whatever variants there may be after genome sequencing, these positive samples or individuals that were identified should have been isolated properly. And if we are assured of that, transmission will be reduced among this population. I understand these different variants have this different characteristics. Some are more transmissible than the other. But again, let me go back. If we do the isolation, quarantine, testing, and all of these protocols that we have, we can be able to prevent the spread of this variant. I agree with you that there should be this timely results to inform the public, the local officials, and we are doing just that. But of course, we have these limitations and we are trying to improve on that.
Well, let's take the case of the seafarers in Butuan, for example, Undersecretary. Have their samples been sequenced?
Yes, it is now with the Philippine Genome Center. These are 5 samples that we have been able to collect from these individuals, and it's going to be part of our next sequencing process.
And when do we know, when will we know the results? What's the turnaround time?
Well, it's going to be 5 to 6 days, but I guess again, we need to assume that these are specific variants because they are coming from this high-risk country.
Exactly. And one of them slipped out.
Yes, and we were able to locate them. This individual, we were able to locate, and also those, the driver and the helper inside the transport public vehicle. But we are still trying to look for those other 3 individuals who rode with this specific individual. So contact tracing is being done already. The family of this individual was contact traced also, and they are all in quarantine.
All right. I also wanted to ask you, all these cases, what's the latest on their vaccination? Have they been vaccinated?
All of these 8 active individuals for now are not vaccinated for me.
So they were not vaccinated prior to contracting the disease. All right. Because you know what's happening in all the other countries that I mentioned a while ago. And these countries have a better vaccination number than ours. And yet, there's still that infection, the spread of the infection that's ongoing. In fact, CDC has called it a pandemic within a pandemic, a pandemic for the unvaccinated. How is this affecting our own vaccination program, our own tracing program? There has to be some sort of an effect. But some people have this observation, again, Undersecretary, that it seems like it's just business as usual a year and a half into this pandemic for the health department.
It's not really business as usual, Carmina. We have ramped up our efforts since the start of the pandemic. We can see that we are trying to speed up our vaccination because we know that the vaccination or the vaccines can really help a lot, especially in controlling or reducing the number of those severe cases and hospitalizations and deaths. If you try to look at the experiences across the globe, you would see that even though cases are increasing in certain parts or in certain countries, but you will see that their hospitalizations and deaths are not increasing. So we are really seeing the effects of the vaccines right now, especially against the Delta variant. So what we are doing right now is for us to be more focused. We're trying to expand our capacity as what we had been doing from the very start. And I think we have, we had gains already, but there are still a lot to be improved.
For example, when it comes to our frontliners, just a couple of days ago, Indonesia recorded the highest number of deaths among their doctors, and these were vaccinated individuals. And of course, the next discussion there is booster shots for the frontliners. Where are we in that discussion? I know that this is an FDA decision to make, but what is the DOH's assessment regarding this?
First, Carmina, I'd just like to qualify what you just said about the Indonesian article or this news story. How many are these healthcare workers and how many were vaccinated as against those unvaccinated? And how many among these vaccinated died? And when we tried to look at the numbers and the statistics, it showed that it's just about less than 2%. And 98% of those vaccinated were protected against severe infections and deaths. I just like to say that so that public will be informed that vaccines work. Second, as you say that this booster doses, we had been discussing continuously with all of our experts. It's not just the vaccine experts panel, the health technology assessment experts, our TAG experts and all. And it is unanimous actually that booster doses cannot be implemented for now here in our country. First, because there is still insufficient evidence. Foremost for the national government will be the safety of its population. And until we can have sufficient evidence for the safety of this booster dosing, that's the time that we will be recommending this to be implemented. Second would be that there should be this equity consideration for now. We all know that there are still a lot of our population who has yet to receive the vaccines. If we introduce booster shots, then we will be able to the possibility of setting aside again some portions of the population unvaccinated because we're going to give booster shots will be there. So we would want to weigh this properly, study it properly, and then we will be giving recommendations at that appropriate time.
And finally, Undersecretary, these countries that are currently experiencing surges in infections and the countries that have also made gains in their vaccination program, they're revisiting their vaccination target. They're revisiting those numbers. Some are even floating the idea of a 90% of the population target. How has the Delta variant affected our targets, for example? Are we also looking at increasing the 70% to 90% following the other countries, Undersecretary?
Yes, Carmina, actually, our experts already have given us this kind of evidences where some countries have increased their targets for their herd immunity because of the effect of these different variants in the efficacies of the different vaccines that we have. Even WHO once mentioned that maybe it would be prudent for the Philippines to increase our target to 80 million because of the effect of these variants to our vaccines. But right now, our overall goal and our long-term goal is still herd immunity. That is correct. We are going to wait for further evidence if we need to increase it to more than the 70% that we are targeting. But right now, we'd like to focus on the population protection. That is protecting all the vulnerable in the country, including healthcare workers, senior citizens, and those with comorbidities, and those highly burdened areas, reaching about 30 to 50%, and that we can say that we have protected the vulnerable in our population.
And we're going to have to leave it at that. Maria Rosario Vergeire, Undersecretary of the DOH, also its spokesperson. Thank you so much for joining us today. Keep safe. Take care.
Thank you, Carmina.